Hello everyone and welcome back to Brain Box Unleashed. This is the second part of the explanation of the chapter Cultural Change, and in this video we'll be covering Sanskritization and Westernization. We have already covered social reforms of the 19th and early 20th century in the first part, and if you've missed that video you can click on the link on the upper right hand corner of your screen, or you can click on the eye icon in the upper right hand side. So let us begin. Before we start with Sanskritization, we need to understand the four main varnas of the Hindu society or the Hindu social system. So let us see what they are. So these are the four main varnas. First you have Brahmins, then Kshatriyas, then Vaishyas, and finally Shudras. So, and this is the typical hierarchy that is present in society. We have Brahmins at the top and Shudras at the bottom, and the most purest form of the most purest caste, or as it is believed, are the Brahmins. Okay, and then you have Kshatriyas, the Vaishyas, and finally Shudras. Shudras are not considered that pure like the Brahmins or Kshatriyas or Vaishyas, and there are also impure castes. Okay, so the concept of purity and pollution is there a lot in caste system, because the upper three castes are considered to be pure, whereas the lowest caste, that is the Shudras, they are considered to be impure, and whatever many actions of theirs are considered to be polluting because they usually do very menial kind of jobs. Okay, and in ancient India, when caste was, everything revolved around caste in the society, the work that the people do depended upon their caste, and that is true even today in the 21st century. We see that in some cases, but at that time it was entirely dependent upon caste, whatever kind of work the people did. For example, Brahmins, they were mostly engaged in teaching, learning, and you know, they worked as priests and they used to conduct religious ceremonies, be it some kind of puja or a wedding ceremony. And then you had the Vaishyas, then you had the Kshatriyas, who used to be they were mainly nobles and they belonged to the royal family, or they were military officers, administrators, and they were mainly engaged in warcraft, okay, and in warfare, and they used to train in war methods. Then you have the Vaishyas, who were traders or businessmen or agriculturalists, and their main job was to engage themselves in the financial aspect of the economy. Then the Shudras, they were mainly working class or the laborers, and they did work which did not require a specific skill set, and they used to work as farm helpers. They used to work in the fields as laborers, then they used to do the washing, cleaning, and other kinds of, they used to work as servants in the homes of the upper castes. And so they did very small jobs, or at least their work was thought to be small by the upper castes. Now, the upper three castes, that are the Brahmins, Kshatriyas, and Vaishyas, they are known as the twice born castes, okay, or the Dvija castes. Now, what does that mean? It means like these castes, the people of these castes, they are born twice. Once when they are born physically or biologically, when they come into this world, and the second one, or the second birth, is more of a spiritual birth, and that happens when the Upanayana ceremony takes place. Now, Upanayana ceremony is that ceremony where they wear the sacred thread around their shoulder to the waist, and that ceremony means like they are getting initiated into their caste. Okay, for example, if that person belongs to the Brahmin caste, then that person, a child of certain age, when he comes of a certain age, he gets accepted into a school. For example, some guru will take him as his student and start teaching him all the methods and knowledge, whatever is required to be a Brahmin. Okay, he'll start learning the Vedas, the Upanishads, the Puranas. Then for a Kshatriya child, he will start learning warfare, the different techniques and methods of war, of battle, and he'll learn statecraft, how to govern people and how to administrate. Okay, so those kinds of things he'll learn. For a Vaishya, he'll learn the crafts of business, the knowledge of business, how to conduct business properly. Then for Shudras, they are not they don't fall in the Dvija caste category, so, and they don't have a specific skill set. Okay, so no Upanayana initiation ceremony takes place for the Shudras. And the, like I said, this is the hierarchy. Okay, the topmost caste is the Brahmins, then in the end you have the Shudras. Now let us start with Sanskritization. Let us see what Sanskritization is. The term Sanskritization was coined by M.N. Srinivas. And M.N. Srinivas, he was an Indian sociologist and anthropologist. And he defined Sanskritization as a process by which a lower caste or a lower tribe or a lower group in the society, he tries to take over the customs, rituals, beliefs, ideology and lifestyle of a higher caste, and particularly of a twice born caste or a Dvija caste. Okay, and that process is known as Sanskritization. So suppose a Shudra family, they want to improve their social status, they start copying the lifestyle, the rituals and the customs of the a Kshatriya family, of a Kshatriya caste, and that process is known as Sanskritization. Now Srinivas says that although mostly Sanskritization happens in the Hindu society or in Hinduism, it can be seen in other religious groups as well. And his studies show that wherever a highly Sanskritized caste is present, say wherever Brahmins are in majority, there Sanskritization can be seen. Because since the Brahmins are in majority and the lower castes are of small numbers, they try, in order to increase their status, they try to copy the customs of the Brahmins. Okay, so Sanskritization happens. But where a non-Sanskritic caste is dominant, for example, say an area where the majority of the population are Shudras, there you will not see Sanskritization because they don't have to compare themselves with the other caste. They are fine living as a Shudra in that area because no such discrimination happens. Okay, so in that area what happens is de-Sanskritization, the opposite of Sanskritization happens. Then Srinivas also says that lower caste usually undergo Sanskritization in order to improve their position in the caste hierarchy, in the local caste hierarchy. Okay, and when they do that, when they undergo the process, they actually assume that that by undergoing Sanskritization, by trying to copy an upper caste, his or her political or economic status will increase in the society, and that's why he does it. And he also feels that it will actually bring him closer to the great tradition of Hinduism. It's almost like coming closer to God. Like for example, when somebody visits a pilgrim site, okay, say Amarnath, then they over there, when they go there, they actually feel closer to God, right? So the same they feel with Sanskritization, because the upper castes are thought to be superior or more purer than the Shudra. So a Shudra will feel that if he tries behaving like a Brahmin, he'll come closer to God. And but the process of Sanskritization, it is not very easy in India, and because the lower castes were trying to become like the upper castes did not feel very comfortable with it. They did not want a lower caste trying to behave like them and trying to, you know, come to their, you know, status level in the society. So they used to, whenever they used to see any such case of Sanskritization, they used to punish whoever was practicing it. Okay. Sanskritization suggests a process whereby people want to improve their status through adoption of names and customs of culturally high placed people, high placed groups. So how do they try to copy other people? Like, obviously they try to copy the customs and all of the higher placed groups. They even try to take the names, surnames. Usually, most of the time they try to take the surnames of the upper caste. Like in India, when somebody, by seeing anybody's surname, you can know what caste he belongs to, right? So in order to increase his social standing, they used to even he used to change his name as well. The reference model is usually financially better off. In both, the aspiration or desire to be like the higher placed group occurs only when people become wealthier. So what, now here it says the reference model is usually financially better off. Now what do you mean by reference model? I'll explain that with the help of an example. Suppose group A, there are two groups, group A and group B. Now group A belongs to, is a lower caste people, and group B belongs to a upper caste. So now when group A tries to copy group B becomes the reference model for group A, right? Group A is trying to change their behaviors, trying to change their customs by looking at the customs of group B, right? So they're taking group B as a reference. So they become the reference model. And usually when Sanskrit groups undergo Sanskritization, they actually take those groups as reference models who are financially better off, who have wealth in the society. And they think that and if they try to copy them, they'll also become wealthier in society. Sanskritization has been criticized for a number of reasons. Let us see why it has been criticized. Firstly, it has been criticized for exaggerating social mobility or the scope of lower castes to move up the social ladder, for it leads to no structural change but only positional change of some individuals. In other words, inequality continues to persist, though some individuals may be able to improve their positions within the unequal structure. Now, Sanskritization has been criticized because, see, now caste system is thought to be as a closed system. There is not much scope for mobility within the system. Okay, like how class is a very mobile system, right? One person can be poor, but he can easily gain wealth and move up the class, right? Move up the hierarchy. But caste is not like that. When you are born, you are born into a caste. It's not because you earn your caste. It's not given to you by choice. Not because you wanted a caste and you got it. It's not like that. You are born into it, right? So there is not much scope of mobility in caste system. Now Sanskritization has been telling that no, there is movement, there is a chance of movement up the social ladder. You can actually go up the hierarchy. But that's why it has been criticized, because It is exaggerating this aspect of social mobility and saying that the lower caste can actually improve their status in the society by Sanskritization. But in reality, it does not lead to any big structural change. It's just a minor positional change and only of some individuals, right? A lot of people or everybody is not undergoing Sanskritization. Only a few people are undergoing Sanskritization. And even if they undergo Sanskritization, it's just only a positional change. It does not change the structure of a structure in any kind. Okay, so that's why it has been criticized. Secondly, it has been pointed out that the ideology of Sanskritization accepts the ways of the upper caste as superior and that of the lower caste as inferior. Therefore, the desire to imitate the upper caste is seen as natural and desirable. Now, Sanskritization, it accepts that upper caste people are superior and the lower caste people are inferior. And therefore, if a lower caste tries to copy the customs of the upper caste, it is completely natural because he does not want to be inferior and he wants to be superior. That and thereby, by choosing to undergo Sanskritization, he can actually become superior. So now Sanskritization accepts this, okay, and that's why it has been criticized. So Sanskritization tries to normalize the understanding or the thought, thinking that upper caste people are superior and the lower caste people are inferior. Thirdly, Sanskritization seems to justify a model that rests on inequality and exclusion. It appears to suggest that to believe in pollution and purity of groups of people is justifiable or all right. Therefore, to be able to look down on some groups just as the upper castes look down on the lower castes is a mark of privilege. In society where such a worldview exists, imagining an equal society becomes difficult. Now, it's an extension of the second point actually. Now, Sanskritization, it seems to justify that, you know, some castes are pure and some castes are impure, and therefore some castes are excluded because of that. Okay, and it accepts society to be unequal, and it actually accepts the practice of the upper caste looking down on the lower caste. It actually accepts the practice of discrimination, caste discrimination. And that's why it has been criticized, because if we want, if we think like that, okay, if we think that some people are superior and some people are inferior, we cannot expect to have an equal society. We cannot expect to have an egalitarian society. Okay. And number four, since Sanskritization results in the adoption of upper caste rites and rituals, it leads to practices of secluding girls and women, adopting dowry practice instead of bride price, and practicing caste discrimination against other groups, etc. Now, upper caste women are more kept in confinement and have more restrictions than a lower caste woman. Okay, so when a lower caste undergoes Sanskritization to become an upper caste, it has to follow this practice of putting restrictions on its women, right? So that is actually a bad change in the society. And also, upper caste people, they have dowry as a practice. They have dowry as a custom, and the lower caste people, they have bride price as a custom. Now, what do you mean by dowry? Dowry is when the bride's family gives wealth or of any kind to the groom's family, right? The groom takes from the bride. But in bride price, it's the opposite. The groom has to give to the bride's family. Okay, so when the lower caste when a lower caste person undergoes Sanskritization, he starts copying this custom of practice of dowry. he leaves behind bride practice and then sorry bride price and he takes up the custom of dowry, which is again a bad change. Okay, and when he becomes an upper caste, he also feels that it is okay now to look down upon the other lower castes and discriminate against them, okay, and hold them in low regard. So that is again a bad change. That's why Sanskritization has been criticized. And the fifth point, or fifth reason why Sanskritization is criticized is because suppose now, like we learned earlier, that occupation was based upon caste, right? Brahmins did a certain kind of work, Kshatriyas did a certain kind of work, and Shudras did a certain kind of work. So when a Shudra tries to become an upper caste, he will have to leave behind his occupation, right? And that is actually bad, because now, since he was doing a certain kind of a job, say he was working as a craftsman of any sort, okay, he actually has knowledge, he has expertise in that field, right? In whatever work he was doing, he has some kind of an expertise on it. And when he leaves behind that work, there is loss of knowledge, there is loss of information. That knowledge that he had with him doesn't get passed on to his family or to his to the younger generation of his family, right? So there is he might have some knowledge on medicine, he might have some knowledge on agriculture, animal husbandry, ecology, and those will all be lost. Okay, so that's why it has been criticized, because the kind of work that the lower castes do are thought to be degrading, or and they are actually shamed for it. Okay, now we move on to westernization. M.N. Srinivas, he defines westernization as the changes brought about in Indian society and culture as a result of over 150 years of British rule. The term subsuming changes occurring at different levels: technology, institutions, ideology, and values. Now, we know that the British have ruled over us for like 150 to 200 years, right? And obviously, in that period, that rule has caused some structural change as well as cultural change in the society. We have already seen what kind of structural changes happened, and now we are seeing the cultural changes, right? So westernization was actually a result of that British rule, and that change happened at different levels, be it technology, institutions, our ideology, and our values. So everything underwent certain kind of change, and that is westernization, because Britain is to the west of India, right? And since we are getting influenced by the customs of the west, it's known as westernization. Now, there are different kinds of westernization. One kind was when it happened to a small group of people who first came in contact with the Western culture. And this small group was usually the ones who, like the British, wanted an educated Indian middle class, right, who would actually do their work, would help them in their administrative work, and they were the first people who came in contact with their Western ideas, Western culture, and so they got westernized in their thought and in their customs and in their thinking. So that was one kind of westernization that happened, and this group actually supported the expansion of westernization. They actually wanted, they had seen that some Western values were actually good, they were actually progressive, and so they wanted the Indian society to be westernized. Most of the 19th century reformers that we learned earlier, that we learned about earlier, were actually of this kind. Okay, they belong to this group. Then apart from this, there is another kind of westernization that happened in a more general manner, and more number of people came in contact with the Western culture. There was a general spread in all directions, okay, and it can be in seen in the use of new technology, maybe some kind of new technology the people were using, which came from the West, maybe some dress, food, some habits and styles of people in general. Suppose some person, a girl, she went to college and she learned about, say, the dress styles of the British people, and so she started dressing in that manner. She got influenced by it and she started dressing in that manner. So that is a kind of westernization. Maybe she learned about fish and chips. You know, British people, they have fish and chips as a staple food there. So maybe she started eating more of fish and chips. So that is one kind of westernization, instead of dal and sabzi and rice, you know. Then now, even now, if we see, most of the middle class homes will have a television set, a fridge, a sofa set, a dining table, chairs in the living room, right? So these are all Western influences, because a traditional Indian home did not have such kind of setup earlier. Okay, it was only as a result of westernization. Now, apart from affecting our life and apart from affecting our thinking, westernization actually influenced, or the West actually influenced, Indian art and literature. Okay, so now the kind of art the artists were creating had Western influences in it. Even the literary works of the people were influenced by Western ideas. Now, Srinivas had said that lower caste people, they wanted to be Sanskritized, and upper caste people wanted to be Westernized. But this statement cannot be, you know, it's not applicable to the whole of India, because India is such a diverse country and everybody picks up on things differently, right? Everybody has different experiences with things. So it is difficult to generalize this statement and make it applicable to the whole of India. For example, the Thiyas of Kerala or Malabar, they were not from an upper caste, but they made efforts to westernize. Okay, so they were getting more westernized in their lifestyle, and they wanted to do that in order to have a more cosmopolitan life, a more globalized life. So you see that the statement that Srinivas made wasn't true in this case, right? And Western education often Western education often implied opening up to new opportunities for different groups of people in the Northeast. Now, in the Northeast, you see, Christian missionaries had come here, right? And there were tea plantations and all during the British rule. So there was heavy footfall of the British in the Northeast region. And because of that, Northeast people came into contact with Western ideas and lifestyle. So here also people have become Westernized. And they see that the people here, they feel that people here in the Northeast, they feel that Western education will actually help them get more job opportunities. Okay, so that is we usually refer to the colonial impact to discuss Westernization. However, we often find new forms of Westernization in the contemporary period, or Americanization. Now, when we think about Westernization, we actually think of the impact the colonial rule had on us, right? And how they actually influenced us to and helped us get Westernized, right? But when we look at today's times, in the contemporary times, it just does not mean the impact that the colonial period had. Now, more and more people are getting influenced by America, the American lifestyle, right? And it's not just for India, I think. It's for other parts of the world as well. More people have taken to, you know, American lifestyle than the British lifestyle, I would say. And you can see this is a different kind of westernization. Now we can have more than one kind of westernization. We can get influenced by the British people as well as, you know, by the American people. So it doesn't necessarily have to be just one. It can be a mix of both. Okay, so that is it for today. I hope you've understood everything that has been taught in this video. And if you feel like you need to leave a feedback, just drop a comment. And like I've said earlier, if you want the explanations to be in Hindi, just let me know. And thank you for watching. Bye bye.